Hello, hello, and welcome to Bla Bla Black Sheep, a weekly podcast where I, Sarah Cork, the best AKA maid, answer your yarny questions. If this is your first time here, welcome. I'm so glad you're here. If you're coming back for the second or 100th time, not 100 because we haven't gotten that far, but we will. And I still want to say thank you. It means so much to me. You're the best. I would love it if you would like this video, share it with a friend, subscribe. It would mean the world to me. It helps others see the podcast, get the news out that we're here, we're in community doing great things, learning and chatting, all those wonderful things. So, all right, what am I wearing today? I'm wearing something very special. I'm going to be wearing something very special. This is the very last project that my mom made. And it's extra special because I helped her pick this project. I'll be honest, I'm not sure what the yarn is. I kind of think it might, it might be Malabrigo. It's gorgeous. But she wanted a simple project that would really show off the yarn and that wasn't going to take too much mental capacity. And so this is what I helped her choose. A few episodes back, I hear the tippy tap of Weston. Here he comes. a few episodes back, I wore a version of this shawl and told you all about how it wasn't the full shawl because I didn't know anything about doing yarn substitution at that point, and I did not get enough of the yarn, and it was on clearance, so I couldn't get more. So I ended up with like a little bandana instead. This is the 22.5 degrees shawl by Martina Behm. Oh, poor baby. Okay, now he's got himself stuck. it's a lovely shawl. I've made it a couple times. I made it, when I, didn't have enough yarn. Then I went back and I got more yarn and I made it and I lost that one, which made me so sad. I lost it in a move. And then, I started making another one and I have not finished it yet. I hope to, excuse me, at some point, but it's a great little shawl, great for new knitters, because it's pretty simple, and I believe the 22.5 is the angle of the triangle that you're making, which is fun. It's, as you could see, a shorter depth, which I love, because I'm a shorter depth. So yeah, that's what I'm wearing. What is bringing me joy is the fact that you guys, I was supposed to go to Chicago. Was that just last weekend? No, 2 weekends ago. I was supposed to go to Chicago and I did not. I was going there to teach. It fell through. It's fine. Woo! But instead, are you for serious? Now he wants to come back in. But he got his head stuck in the door. So I did not go down to Chicago, but I didn't know that Appleton had an arts festival that weekend. And so I went twice. I went once on Saturday with my mother-in-law and my boys, and it was miserable. It was so packed. The boys instantly got hot and were over it. It was fine. It was neat to walk around and see. But then I went back on Sunday all by my lonesome, and it was amazing because I got to look as much stuff as I wanted to for as long as I wanted to. Yes, I hear you. Okay, he needs to go potty. I'll be right back. Sorry about that. I normally let him out before I start recording. But he was sound asleep, and I thought, maybe I'll sneak it in. The answer to that is apparently no. Anyways, I had so much fun at that art festival. It brought me so much joy. It was just what I needed. It was blazing hot. God bless the artists who are out there all weekend. selling their stuff and being lovely and friendly and wonderful. Everyone I talked to was amazing. That brought me so much joy. So if you can go to like an arts festival, as the summer finishes out, highly recommend. It's a good time. Don't take your kids. Just leave them at home. They'll be grumpy. Okay. I want to do a quick announcement. I have a lot of stuff stacked on my my little stool here. Why don't you just lay down, silly? There you go. Good boy. So I'm going to start with a little announcement, and then I'm going to show you some of the stuff I got at the art festival and tell you about some of the artists I met. So, okay, you guys, I'm so excited. I'm not going to tell you the whole story of this because, gosh, this will be over an hour if I do. But my Waylen project bag is out in the world. It is officially published. It has been tested and tech edited, as I like to do with all my patterns. And this was a thing. You can read the whole story on my blog. I'll link below. But man, I'm just so pleased. Lots of people, I'll say, have done little bags like this, little Notions bags. But I was talking with Robin of the Bloom and Spindle, and we're like, hey, something different. How about a big old project bag? And I was like, let's see if we can make it happen. And we did. And I'm so excited. It's reinforced on the inside with a bag. And so it's like super sturdy. I have a little special technique that I wasn't sure was going to work to attach the bag to the inside of the crochet bag. It blew my mind. It worked better than I thought it would. It's amazing. And then I made this little tassel, which I'm in love with. Okay. And then I ended up being able to make, with my three skeins of Malabrigo Rios, a big project bag, a Notions bag, and then I just moved it across the room, but also a cup cozy. What a deal. The cup cozy is not published yet, but it will be. And then you'll be able to make all three. So handy. What a great gift. These would be great if you want a gift to people who don't knit or crochet and won't use them as project bags. This would be a great pencil pouch, but they'd also be great for travel. Like, put your jewelry in here, put your, makeup or underwear or something in there, and then you've got a little cup cozy to, like, take with you as you, like, travel along your way. Okay, so I'm so excited about it. I also had yarn to make one that matches my Waylen hat that I made last year. My Waylen hat was my Crochet Cancer Challenge hat, which I've started designing this year, and I'm very excited about. I'm loving this tassel here. It's just so much fun. So I'm thrilled, thrilled about these. Could not be more excited. Definitely gonna teach some classes on these. You guys, lots of people have looked at this and did last year at this stitch, looked at it for the Crochet Cancer Challenge, and they were like, mm-mm, it's too hard. It's not too hard. It's not too hard. You can do this. If you can double crochet, you can do this. I have, of course, I have a video tutorial on how to do it, and so many people have watched that and then been like, oh, yeah, of course. You can do it. You can do it. I'm going to make a special coupon code for you guys because you're just so lovely and I appreciate you. It's going to go until, I don't know. Look at the show notes for details. I'll give you a special discount code because this is going to come out after all the discount codes have discontinued discounting. Yeah, check out the show notes for a little special blah blah black sheep discount on that pattern. It'll only last for a little while, so yeah, that's my little announcement. Let's talk small businesses. You guys, I went to the art festival here in Appleton, but then when I was at home with my family, my sister's friend invited us to get out of the house for a little bit, which was a very welcome invitation. There was an arts festival by her down in Waukee, Iowa, if you know where that is. And friends, I got a look. I think I have enough earrings to wear a new pair of handcrafted earrings for the rest of the year. That might be a little exaggeration, but I got a lot of earrings. Oh, I'm so excited about them. So let me share with you the earrings that I'm currently wearing. This was one of those ones that I looked at briefly while I had my peoples with me and they were grumpy, and so I did not end up purchasing. But then I regretted it. I got home and I thought about them a whole lot. And so when I went back on Sunday, I bought a pair. I could have bought a lot of pairs. A, because they're very reasonably priced, and B, because they were just so cute. So maybe the owner's sister or friend, lovely lady. We might crochet together later on. These are so unique. These are made out of designer wallpaper. What? They are such fun patterns. And so lightweight. I mean, these are enormous. And I feel like I'm wearing like nothing. It's amazing. So, lovely woman owned company. So creative, so modern and gorgeous. Cloudy Skies Designs. And I'll link all the things in the show notes. So don't worry about like tippy tapping or taking notes or anything. So I'm obsessed with these. Will there be more pairs? Yes, probably. I believe she's a local-ish to me artist. Like, ooh, goodness sakes. Like a Wisconsin artist, not like an Appleton artist, but that was fun. Okay, one of the things I did buy the first day was this guy. My boys were like, yes, mom, you have to buy that. Look at that little painting of that sheep. He is 100% going somewhere. Maybe here. Ooh, that's funny. Maybe, I don't know, maybe there. A little sheep, maybe. Over here. I don't know, he's so cute though. He's so cute. And so I got that, and actually my mother-in-law was hemming and hawing over one, and a painting of hers. Vicky, talked to Vicky a little bit. She is just a lovely person. I took some video of her booth. I think I'll put my farmer's market, my art festival. I'll do like a bit at the end to show you like some of the booths of the people and just a little some activity of the art festival if you're interested in that. It was fun. She has lots of gorgeous work. So the first day my mother-in-law was like, oh, this is really pretty. She's not a big like fine art person. And so she was like, I just don't know. And I was like, give it to me. I'm buying it for you. Forget I bought it and I'll give it to you at Christmas. So yay for some Christmas shopping done. But then I was a little jealous of what I bought for my mother-in-law. And so the next day I went back and I got myself this. Right? Oh, it's amazing. And I can't decide if I want to hang it up in here somewhere or if I want to hang it. I've got like a little gathering, that's not the right word, but I can't think of the right word, of really bold, fun art right as you come in our entryway right out there. So this is by VS Designs, and it's Vicky Strobel. And again, I'll put a link down below to all of her things so that you can go check out her amazing art. I'm not going to guarantee that she has sheep left, but so many pretty paintings. Real hand paintings, you know, considering that it's like an original work of art, extremely reasonably priced, I felt. She had this big one. And I looked at it and I was like, oh, that would be amazing over my fireplace. Maybe someday. Maybe I'll like save up for that. That'll be like my treat if I like meet a milestone or something. I don't know. It was amazing. gorgeous artwork from her. There was a photographer. Okay, for a minute, I thought I didn't. Mary Collette, and she has Mary's canvases. She had lots of really, a really wide range of photography. And it all started with this guy. Look at him. Am I obsessed with sheep? Yes, yes I am. Only thing that would have made it better is if he was a little black sheep for blah blah black sheep. But I'm gonna get him a frame, hang him somewhere in here probably because he's sheepy. But then I also got this one because I have coneflowers like this growing for my butterflies. And then this was something I remember my mom growing in our garden when I was little. So very meaningful. So frame those, hang those up somewhere. I'll have to show you when I get them hung up where I choose to put them. So very excited about that. And then like as I was about to walk out the door, no door to an arts festival, but you know what I mean. I just poked in this little shop that had lots of big things that I could not afford. Or I guess I should say I chose not to afford. But then I noticed this little cute piece, the flowers, and I am obsessed with the unique color choices. You know that that teal right there, that's my color. But then it's got the hot pink. I'm obsessed. So another one that I will frame and put up somewhere, probably in here somewhere. And this is, oh, that's the back of the business card. That's why I couldn't find her name. Jenny Yagro. Yagro. Really lots of really fun, funky, florally things there. So lots of fun. I had such a good time. My friend, Rin of Cheeky Ceramics was there. I got to talk to her. I should have grabbed them to show you. I grabbed a magnet and a little pair of bird earrings from her that I absolutely love. And there you go. So many small businesses. I will continue to share more because I got, like I said, so many earrings. So it's fine. It's lovely. It's great. There you go. All right. Questions. Let's get into it. Okay. Question number one says, okay, I was getting used to seeing Christmas in July, but what's up with Augustmas? Why? Frankly, I don't understand either of them, and I'm not ready for Christmas. Okay, I feel this. Christmas in July felt, and still a little bit feels, very like marketing-y. That's not a word, but you know what I mean. Like, it's all just a ploy from the craft people, really. I don't, all the people, right? I mean, other people than craft people do Christmas in July. And I was always like, you just want to sell me stuff. And I think that's true. I do think that's how it got started. But the more I thought about it, and the more I thought about the stress and the pressure we put on ourselves around the holidays, the more I have, like, in a very different non-marketing-y way, thought differently about Christmas in July. The Augustmas thing, I think, is just, I haven't done a lot of research into this, but from what I've seen, it's one designer, and they are publishing a bunch of stockings. And so what they're encouraging people to do is get started making them now. They're having a knit along, and dive in now and then you'll have your stockings in time for Christmas. So that kind of goes along with how I have come to appreciate Christmas in July, and that is the fact that I firmly believe in preparation. I'm not always the best at it, but I do appreciate good preparation. Future me always appreciates when past me has thought ahead and planned for things. And so to me, the purpose of Christmas in July is this. July A is 6 months from December. And let's be honest, if you decide as you are putting out your holiday decorations that everybody needs a handmade stocking, you'll be lucky if you get one done by Christmas, unless you are like a prolific knitter or crocheter, or you use super like bulky yarn or something like that. But the time to be thinking about what you want to do for the holidays is, I was gonna say now, but it's August. I'll be honest with you guys. I had wanted to do some things around Christmas in July, not in the marketing-y kind of way, but like in a let's all like think about the holidays and not be stressed about them when it comes to November and December. But as you know, or if you don't know, you can go back and watch my previous episode. As you know, July did not go at all how I thought it was going to go. So that didn't happen. Maybe next year. But I think it's a great time to be thinking about and preparing what holiday gifts do I want to make. That includes not only like friends and family, but also like teacher gifts. Oh my gosh. If I am not, or was not for years, I've done Lazy Genius style. If you don't know the Lazy Genius, highly recommend Kendra Adachi. I've decided once on gifts for teachers, which is a Lazy Genius principle, and now I don't think about it. I just do what I've always done, and I don't feel bad about it. But before that, it was a lot of like, oh, shoot, school ends next week. What am I going to do? So if you think about that now, and not even necessarily, like, I know you probably don't know who your kids' teachers even are, but if you think, I would like to make something small or large. Some people make really, really big, nice gifts for their kids' teachers, which is so generous of you. I don't do it, but it's very generous if you do. But just to be thinking that I would like to make them a gift helps you suss out how much you need to make. I would say, like, pick some patterns, some time frames. If you know you want to make something for your niece or your nephews, all get a new hat or something like that. Compile all those things so that you know I have 10 gifts to make. I have 2 gifts to make. I'm going to make one really big gift for someone who's special for me and let go of the other gifts because those people don't appreciate them anyway. So I think a practical purpose of Christmas in July is thinking ahead and planning. You can pick out projects. You can like estimate how much time things are going to take you. You can, start slowly purchasing yarn and working on projects now instead of, we know that a lot of times the holidays are quite expensive, and then that's a big crunch on your wallet too. So if you can be watching for sales, you know, as the season turns from summer to fall, you're going to get some good sales on yarn. A lot of times, especially if you're shopping like big box stores, so like, you know, if you need something for nieces and nephews or a new baby that needs to be washable and you want to use like a big box yarn, now's a great time to be thinking about that and planning ahead. So, can Christmas in July be very just like marketing-y? Yeah. But can you use it for your own purposes to help future you be more relaxed at the holiday season? Also, yes. And that's what I recommend doing. So take advantage of the fact that people are trying to market to you and have a lot of their holiday stuff on sale to snag some of that and prepare for the future. All right, question number two. I'm finding all sorts of fun fiber combinations that I would love to try. Opossum and yak and silk, oh my! How do I know what kind of projects they'll be good for? So I assume the unique fiber combinations. So, a few things. A, you just gotta try them. The very, very best way to understand a yarn is to work with it. Whether it's making a full project or just, you know, doing a little swatch. Working with it in your hands and using it and seeing how it behaves is going to be the best way for you yourself to gain knowledge. So what I would recommend is snag a skein of something you like, depending on the unique fiber blend, can depend on how expensive it is. And some of them be real expensive. Like, I think yak was one of them that I was like, woo! but if you can grab a skein of it and then you can do a swatch and make your swatch. Take the time while you're making your swatch to notice, what does this feel like? How does this behave? Is it splitting? Is it not splitting? Do I like to use a metal hook or needle or a wooden hook or needle is better? Those kinds of things. And just notice as you're working with it how it works up. Then block it and see how it behaves. Different fibers bloom differently. Even different yarns within the same fiber category bloom differently. I just finished a shawl with some blue sky fiber wool stock. It was lovely to work with, but then I blocked it and oh, it bloomed gorgeously. I'm so excited. And I have to say, little plug for blue sky yarn, which I love. Full disclosure, I am partnering with them for a couple designs, but I've loved them from the beginning. One of my first fancy yarns I bought, my mom bought for me because I couldn't afford it, was a blue sky fiber. Anyways, I digress. Super impressed. My shawl had a very soft pink right next to a deep maroon, and red and purple colors tend to bleed the most in blocking. And so I was a little worried because they were right next to each other and I did not want my baby pink or my soft pink to be influenced by the maroon. Nary a color bleed in sight. I was so impressed. So highly recommend, absolutely in love with the deep. If I could remember the name, I would tell you, but you'll know what I'm talking about if you go on their website. It's a real deep maroon wool stock light. Gorgeous. One of their classic colors. Anyways, I digress. Oh, but it bloomed. Sorry, I was like, what was I talking about? Oh my gosh, you guys. It bloomed beautifully and did not bleed. It bloomed and did not bleed. So it was wonderful, but you don't know how a yarn is going to behave until you fully work through all of it. So if you can buy a skein and work with it a little bit, that's awesome. Now you might be saying, if I pay $35 a skein for some unusual fiber combination, I don't want to take part of that skein to just make a swatch just to play with it. I want to use every last little bit in a project that I'm going to love. And so for that, I would say go to the experts and ask for advice. This is the thing I was scared to do when I first started knitting, because that's where I started. I was so scared to ask yarn shop owners, like, how does this behave? What's your experience with it? What's a good project to make out of this? Because there are some things that are awesome for certain types of projects and not awesome for other types of projects. I'm thinking baby alpaca tends to be extremely soft and incredibly drapey, but it also tends to not have a lot of structure or bounce back. And so if you make a sweater out of it, the sweater can get like super stretched out and droopy because it just has so much drape and give to it. So there'll be no structure to your sweater. But you don't know that necessarily unless you work with it or you ask someone who has worked with it. So ask your local yarn shop owner. Even if it's like a hypothetical, like you didn't see it in their shop, which if you didn't see it in their shop, they might not have experience with it. But you could say like, oh my gosh, I've been seeing this yarn around with yak in it. Do you have any yarn with yak? And they might say, yes, it's right over here. And then you get to like squish it and feel it, which if you get a chance to do that, it's amazing. Definitely squish it. But even if they say no, you can say like, well, do you have any knowledge of it? Like, that's very unusual. What do you know about yarn with yak in it? Have you ever used yarn with yak in it? Do you have suggestions about what types of projects might be good for a yarn with yak in it? Or silk or whatever? You know, how do I care for this yarn? Those are all great questions. And local yarn shop owners are like librarians. They spend their days doing stuff with the fiber that, you know, you could not have that much experience because it's not your job like it is their job to have that experience. So ask away. I'm almost positive they would love to talk to you. And if they wouldn't love to talk to you, go find a different yarn shop. So, those are my suggestions. Give it a swatch, give it a squish, and ask for help. Get some experience yourself or ask for help on, and borrow someone else's knowledge because that's lovely too. So there you go. All right. Thank you for joining me today and listening to my talk and seeing all my purdies. I'm very excited about all of them. I need to find some time this week to hang them places so I can get them off my flat surfaces and hung up on my walls. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna cut in a little bit here at the end with some of my video from some of the vendors at the Arts Festival. And I hope you enjoy and take some time to talk. Hey, take some time to talk to another artist this week, whether it's someone you admire who is within the yarn crafting world, or it's somebody who makes earrings out of wallpaper. Artists are great people, and getting to know them and chat with them always makes me happy. So... thank you again for joining me, and